Theresienstadt.
This time it reached us, the transport to the east. We were loaded into these wagons for cattle. And it went for 2 days and one night.
And
the second day, it was December. But it was warm inside, because we made the heat. We heated it up with our temperature, body temperature. One evening, the train came to a stop. The next day in the evening. And the doors were opened. And there was a terrible screaming, out, 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 out. We were shocked. We didn't know what's going on, where we are. We saw only SS with dogs. And we saw in the distance, in symmetric lights were. But we didn't know where we are, what the lights, the thousands of lights were meaning. We only heard this shouting, out, out, out.
And raus.
Yes, just exactly. And schnell, schnell, schnell. Out we came of these wagons. We had to line up. And there were some people with striped uniforms. We didn't know what the stripes are. And I asked one in Czech, where are we? And it was a Polish who understood my Czech, and he told me Auschwitz. But it didn't mean anything to me. What is Auschwitz? I didn't know about Auschwitz anything. We were led into a so-called family camp, Familienlager B2B. Children, men and women together, without any selection beforehand. Men from the Männerlager, they came in and told us that Auschwitz is a Vernichtungslager, where there are burning people. And we didn't believe. In this camp, there was already a transport who left Theresienstadt in September, 3 months before us. They didn't believe too, because we were all together and nobody was taken away, and nobody was burned. We didn't believe it.
Those Czech Jews from Theresienstadt, from the ghetto near Prague, came into one particular part of the camp, which was called Bauabschnitt 2B, 2B. At that time I was working as a registrar in 2A. The division between 2A and 2B was only one electrical fence, through which nobody could climb, but you could speak through it. In the morning, I could sort out the whole situation. There were a number of surprising circumstances. The families, this means men, women, and children, were taken together and nobody was gassed. They took with them their luggage into the camp. And they were not shorn. Their hair was left. So they were in a different position than anything which I have seen until now. I didn't know what to think about it, and nobody knew. But in the main registrar's office, it was known that all those people have got special cards which had a remark on them. S. B. mit 6-monatiger Quarantäne. S. B., we knew what means, Sonderbehandlung, which meant gassing. And quarantine, also we knew what it means. But it didn't make sense to us that somebody should be kept in the camp for 6 months in order to be gassed after 6 months. Therefore, it was left open to interpretation if SB, Sonderbehandlung, always means death in gas chamber, or if perhaps it has got a double meaning. And the 6 months were supposed to elapse on 7th March. In December, and I think it was close to 20th December, another transport of from Theresienstadt came, also about 4,000 people strong, which was added to the first transport into the camp B2B. Also, men, women, and children were left together. Families were not torn apart. Old people, young people, everything was remained intact. And their hair was left, and their personal property was left. They could wear civil clothes, whatever they had. They were given a sort of a different treatment. A school was arranged for the children in a special barrack. The children soon made a theater there. And also, it was not really a very comfortable life because they were cramped. And from the first 4,000 people during the first 6 months, the mortality was about 1,000
times. Were they obliged to work?
Yes, they had to work, but only inside their camp. They were making a new camp road, and they were ornamenting the barracks. They were induced to write letters. Induced to write letters, by the says. To their relatives in the Theresienstadt ghetto, saying that they are all together, etc.
And they had better conditions of food? For
definitely instance? Better conditions of food, better conditions of treatment. I mean, the conditions were so good that within 6 months, including the old people and children, only 1/4 of them died. I mean, this was a very unusually good condition in Auschwitz. And to the children's theater, the SS used to come there and play with the children. Personal relationship was struck up. And of course, one of my tasks as a registrar was to find out the possibility of people who are resistant, who have got a mind for resistance, and to struck up with them a relationship. And
you were already a member of the resistance movement.
Yes, yes. And that was my job as a registrar, that I had the possibility of moving a bit around under various pretexts to carry papers from my part of the camp into the central registry, and at that occasion to meet other people and give them messages, take messages from them. And one of my tasks then was, because I was closest to this camp, to find out if among the members of this transport are people who are suitable for organizing a resistance nucleus. We soon found several ex-members of the International Brigade in Spain. And so in no time, I had a list of about 40 people who had a record from the past of developing some sort of resistance against the Nazism. A special figure emerged among this family camp, a man called Freddy Hirsch. He was a German Jew who emigrated from Germany to Prague. Freddy Hirsch showed a considerable amount of interest for the education of the children who was there. He knew each child by name. And by his upright behavior and obvious human dignity, he became a sort of a spiritual leader of this whole family camp. Now, the March 7th started to near, and this was supposed to give us the signal of what is supposed to happen. But what we did not know for sure.
Im Ende Februar bin ich ausgerückt mit einer Nachtschicht im Krematorium 5. Und so etwa gegenüber Mitternacht kam von der politischen Abteilung der Oberscharführer Hustek und übergab den Oberscharführer Voss einen Schriftstück. Oberscharführer Voss, damals war der Chef von allen vier Krematorien. Ich habe gesehen, wie Voss diesen Schriftstück aufmacht. Und spricht für sich. So, ja, ja, alles Voss. Und wenn der Voss wird nicht sein, dann geht alles zugrunde. Wie kann man das da machen? So hatte er sich über sich gesprochen. Plötzlich sagte er mir, geh und ruf die Kapos. Und ich ging und ruf die Kapo, den Kapo Schleume und den Kapo Fatzek. Die kamen herein und er fragte sie damals, wie viele Stück liegen noch da? Also er hat mit denen geglaubt, Stück, die Leichen. Da sagen die, es könnten sein etwa 500 Stück. Hat er gesagt, also die 500 Stück müssen bis morgen veräschert sein. Sind das 500? Fragte er wieder. Da sagten die vielleicht. Da sagte er, ihr Arschlöcher, was heißt vielleicht? Da ging er heraus und in den Auskleideraum und in diesen Auskleideraum
nehmen die Leichen.
Wo die Leichen waren, gesammelt, weil der Auskleideraum diente in Krematorium 5 gleichzeitig auch als ein Leichenraum, wenn die Vergasung,
nach
der Vergasung waren die wieder hergeschleppt in den Auskleideraum. Und da ging er und wollte es überprüfen. Und in diesem Moment hat er vergessen, dass er diesen Schriftstück auf dem Tisch vergessen hat. Und ich habe diesen Moment ausgenutzt und guck da herein. Und ich war schockiert, was ich da gelesen habe. Das Krematorium wegen der Sonderbehandlung des tschechischen Familienlagers bereitgestellt sollte sein. Und als morgen, also als die Tagschichte ankam, traf ich mich mit Capo Kaminski, der einer der wichtigsten Widerstandskämpfer im Sonderkommando war, und teilte ihnen diese Nachricht mit. Er hat mir erzählt, dass auch in Krematorium 2 einige Vorbereitungen schon getroffen waren, dass die Öfen ja auch bereit waren. Und da hat er mich aufgefordert, sagt er, du hast doch einige deine Kameraden, Landsmänner. Geh doch zu ihnen, die sind doch als Schlosser. Die haben doch die Möglichkeit, in dem Lager B2B zu gehen. Sie sollen doch diesen Menschen sagen, was für ein Schicksal sie erwartet. Sie sollen ihm sagen, wenn sie sich wehren, werden wir den Krematorium in Asche verwandeln. Und sie könnten auch gleich in B2B die Baracken in Feuer setzen. Wir waren fest also überzeugt, dass diese Nacht würde man diese Menschen vernichten. Aber als die Nachtschicht nicht ausrückte, waren wir glücklich. Der Termin war abgeschoben. Und einige Tage geschah es nicht. Aber viele von Häftlingen, auch von den Tschechischen im Familienlager, machten uns Vorwürfe, dass wir Panikmacher waren. Dass wir da etwas, dass wir da etwas denen gesagt haben, was nicht der Wahrheit entspricht.
Approximately by the end of February, a rumor was spread by the Nazis that the family transport will be moved to a place called Heidelberg. The first move was to separate the first family transport from the second family transport by transferring them overnight into the quarantine camp, B2A, where I was a registrar. So I could now speak with those people directly. I talked to Freddy here specifically, and I told him about the possibility that the transport has been his transport, that family transport of the Czechs, has been transferred to the quarantine camp because of the possibility of them being predestined to be gassed on the March 7th. He asked me if I know that for sure. And I said, I do not know it for sure, but it is a serious possibility because there is no record of any train going away from Auschwitz. And usually the offices, the registrars, where the resistance movement had their people, would get wind of such an information, of a transport being prepared out from Auschwitz. And there was no such information. And I explained him the circumstances, and I explained him what it means. And the possibility then would arise that for the first time there are in camp people who are relatively physically preserved, who have some sort of a morale retained, who are certain to go to die, in other words, to be subject to the normal execution procedure, anonymous major execution procedure as usual. And they will know it. They can't be just tricked. And that this is perhaps the time to act. And the action, of course, will have to come out from them. Because there are others whose death was imminent, and that's why the people from the Sonderkommando who worked in the crematorium, which was periodically replaced. And they showed a willingness that if the Czechs, before the gassing, attack the SS, They will join them. Freddy Hirsch objected. He was very reasonable. He said that it doesn't make sense to him that the Germans would keep them for 6 months and feeding the children with milk and white bread in order to gas them after 6 months. On the next day, I got the message, again from the resistance, that it is sure that they are going to be gassed. That the Sonderkommando already received the call for burning the transport. The Sonderkommando knew exactly how many people are going to be gassed, what sort of people, because there were certain rules of work too. So I called up again to Freddy and explained to him that as far as this transport is concerned, included him, they are going to be gassed on the next 48 hours. So he suddenly started to worry. He said, what happens to the children if we start the uprising? He had a very close relationship with the
children.
How
many children were there?
Could be about 100 alive.
And how many people able to fight?
Well, the nucleus was about 30, and now it was not necessary to keep any precautions, and this depends. I mean, if it comes to fighting, even an old woman can pick up a stone. Anybody can fight. I mean, this is difficult to predict. But there was necessary to have a nucleus, and it was necessary to have a leading personality. You see, these are small details which are extremely important. And so he said to me, if he makes the uprising, what is going, no matter what is going to happen to the children? Who is going to take care of them? So I said, the children, I cannot say you anything except that there is no way out for them. They will die whatsoever. That's for sure. This we cannot prevent. The question, what we can do is, who is going to die with them? And how many SS are going to die with them? And how will it impede the whole machinery? Plus the possibility that a part, during the uprising, will find the way out from the camp, which is possible in such a situation. I mean, to break through the guards, because once the uprising starts, some weapons can be expected to be had. And I explained to him that there is absolutely no chance for him or for anybody from that transport, to the best of my knowledge and everybody else's knowledge whom I trust, to survive the next 48 hours.
This took place inside the block?
Inside the block, in my room. And I told him also that the need of the personality and that he has been selected for that. And of course he explained to me that he understands the situation, that it is extremely difficult for him to make any decisions because of the children, and that he cannot see how he can leave those children just to their fate. He was sort of their father. I mean, he was only 30 at that time, but the relationship between him and those children was very strong. And he said to me that, of course, he can see the logic behind my argumentation and that he would like to think about it for an hour, if I could leave him alone to think for an hour. And because I had at that time a room of my own as a registrar, I left him in my room, which was equipped with a table, a chair, and a bed, and some writing instrumentation. And I told him that I will come in an hour's time back. And I came back in an hour, and I could see that he is laying on my bed and that he's dying. He was cyanotic in the face. He had frost around the mouth, and I could see that he has poisoned himself. He took poison. But he was not dead. And because of him being so important, I didn't know what sort of poison he took. But I had, again, a connection to a man called Dr. Kleinman. This Dr. Kleinman was of Polish origin and a French Jew, and medically qualified, And I called Dr. Kleinman immediately to Hirsch and asked Kleinman to do what he can, because this is an important man. And Kleinman inspected Freddy Hirsch, and he said that he thinks that he poisoned himself with a big dose of barbiturates, that it might be perhaps possible to save his life, but he won't be on his feet for a long time to come, and he is going to be gassed in the next 48 hours. And he thinks, Kleinman, that it would be better to leave things as they are and to do nothing. Well, the story after the suicide of Freddy Hirsch developed very fast. The first thing I informed the rest of them, what I told to Hirsch. Secondly, I moved to the Camp 2D to establish the contact with the resistance, with the resistance movement. They gave me bread for the people. Bread, yes, bread and onions, and said that I will get, they don't know any, no decision has been made, and I should come later for instructions. The moment I distributed the bread, something happened, namely a special curfew was made within the camp. All administrative activities were stopped. All guards were doubled. Machine guns, etc., were spread around the quarantine camps, and I was out of contact. The transport, the Czech family transport, was then gassed in the evening. They were put on trucks. All of them knew. They were put on trucks. They behaved very well. We didn't know, of course, where the trucks are going. They were being assured once more that they are going to Heidelberg and not to be gassed. And we knew that if they are going out from the camp, the trucks will turn right when they leave the camp. And we knew that if they turn left, there is only one way, 500 yards, and that's where the crematorium was.
Diese Nacht war ich im Krematorium 2. Kaum sind die Menschen von den Lastwagen ausgestiegen, waren sie beleuchtet mit Reflektoren und müssten durch einen Korridor bis zu die Stiegen, wo die ja da münden in den Auskleideraum, bis zu die Treppen, da beleuchtet durch, also müssten die laufen. Sie waren geschlagen. Wer nicht laufen könnte in Laufschritt, war also bis zum Tode geschlagen. Also von der SS. Also es war ein außergewöhnlicher Gewalt auf diese Menschen aufgesetzt. Jetzt plötzlich,
ohne Worte, ohne Erklärung,
ohne jeden, den plötzlich sind sie ausgestiegen aus den Lastwagen, und da haute zu die SS auf diesen Menschen. Als sie sich befanden in den Auskleideraum, war ich wieder in den hinteren Tür des Auskleideraums, stand ich hinter die hinteren Tür könnte die schreckliche Szenerie zuschauen. Die Menschen waren verblutet. Sie wussten jetzt, wo sie sich befanden. Sie guckten sich an, die Säulen des sogenannten, wie ich schon vorher gesagt habe, internationalen Informationszentrum, der ihnen so viel Schrecken, der hat sie nicht beruhigt. Im Gegenteil, der hat diesen Menschen einen Schrecken eingebracht, weil sie nämlich schon vorher gewusst haben und gehört haben, diese Menschen in den Lager B2B, was da geschah. Sie waren verzweifelt, Kinder unarmen sich, Mütter, Eltern, ältere Menschen weinten. Sie waren unglücklich. Plötzlich könnte man sehen, dass von den Stiegen kamen einige SS-Offiziere an. Unter anderem auch der Lagerführer Schwarzhuber, der vorher doch denen versprochen hat, mit einem Ehrenwort eines SS-Offiziers, dass sie in Heidenbreck überstellt werden. Da habe ich gesehen, wie sie fingen an zu schreien, appellieren, Heidenbreck war eine Täuschung, wir waren belogen, wir wollen leben, wir wollen arbeiten, und guckten dabei in Gesicht den der SS-Henkern. Aber die haben sich, die waren ja wie nicht beteiligt, die haben nur zugeschaut, als plötzlich eine Menge ausbricht. Wahrscheinlich wollten sie sich stellen in die Augen gegen den Schergen, SS-Schergen, und denen sagen, wie sie belogen war. Aber in dem Moment kamen einige Posten und schlagen mit Knüppel zu, und einige waren auch verletzt. In Auskleiderraum. Unter diesen Umständen kam es also unter außergewöhnlicher Härte, die ja waren diese Menschen jetzt gezwungen, sich auszuziehen. Einige haben sich ausgezogen, aber nur die Kleine, eine ganz kleine Menge. Die Mehrheit, die haben nicht diesen Befehl befohlen. Und plötzlich hörte ich, wie ein Chor fängt an, sich singen. Ein Gesang verbreitete sich in den Auskleiderraum. Und da fing an zu klingen, sie singen die tschechische Nationalhymne und die Hatikva. Es hat mich sehr berührt, also dieser Vorfall meiner Landsleuten. Und ich habe mich erfasst, dass mein Leben nicht mehr kein Wert hat. Was soll ich mal leben, für was? Und da ging ich in die Gaskammer mit denen und entschieden zu sterben mit ihnen. Da kamen plötzlich zu mir einige Leute, die mich erkannt haben, weil ich war einige Male mit meinen Freunden mit den Schlosser in Familienslager. Und plötzlich kam eine kleine Gruppe von Frauen zu mir, guckte mich an und sagte, schon in den Gaskammern.
Du warst schon in den Gaskammern.
Und sagte mir also, du willst ja sterben, aber das hat doch keinen Sinn. Dein Sterben wird nicht unseres Leben bringen. Das ist keine Tat. Du musst von hier raus, du musst ja noch berichten über den, was wir leiden, was für ein Ungerecht uns geschehen ist.
That's how it ended with the first Czech family transport. And it was quite clear to me then that the resistance in the camp is not geared for an uprising, but for survival, for the survivors of the members of the resistance. I then decided to act what was called by the members of resistance as anarchic and individualistic activity, like an escape and leaving the community for which I'm co-responsible by that time. The decision to escape, in spite of the policy of the resistance movement at that time, was formed immediately, and I started to press on with the preparations for the escape together with my friend Wetzler, who was extremely important in this matter. And before I left, I spoke with Hugo Lenek, and Hugo Lenek was in command of the second of the resistance group in the second family transport. Yes, and I explained to him that from the resistance movement, they can explain nothing now. Expect nothing but bread. But when it comes to the dying, they should act on their own. As far myself is concerned, I think that if I successfully manage to break out from the camp and bring the information to the right place in the right time, that this might be a help, that I might manage, if I succeed, to bring help from outside. And also it was a firm belief in me that all this was possible because either the victims who came to Auschwitz didn't know what is happening there, or if somebody had the knowledge outside, that the knowledge was I would say that they didn't know, that's it. And I thought that if this will be made known by any means within Europe, and especially within Hungary, from where 1 million Jews were supposed to be transported to Auschwitz immediately in May, and I knew about that, that this might stir up the resistance outside and bring help from outside directly to Auschwitz. And thus the escape plans were finally formulated, and the escape took place on April 7th.
And this is the main and the deep reason why you decided to
suddenly
escape.
At that moment to press on with it. In other words, not to delay anything, but to escape as soon as possible. To inform the world.
About what was going on
right.
in
right.
Auschwitz.
Right.
Now I go back 35 years. Now, I don't go back, you know. It's a matter of... In the middle of 1942, I was thinking to continue my service as a courier between the Polish underground and the Polish government in exile in London. the Jewish leaders in Warsaw learned about it. A meeting was arranged outside of the ghetto. There were two gentlemen. They did not live in the ghetto. They introduced themselves. Leader of Bund, Zionist leader. Now, what transcribed, what happened in our conversation? First, I was not prepared for it. I was relatively isolated in my work in Poland. I did not see many things. In 35 years after the war, I don't go back. I have been a teacher for 26 years. I never mention the Jewish problem to my students. I understand this film. It is for historical record, so I will try to do it. They describe to me what is happening to the Jews. Did I know about it? No, I didn't. They describe to me first that the Jewish problem is unprecedented, cannot be compared with the Polish problem or Russian or any other problem. Hitler will lose this war, but he will exterminate all Jewish population. Do I understand it? The Allies fight for their people. They fight for humanity. The Allies cannot forget that the Jews will be exterminated totally in Poland, Polish and European Jews. They were breaking down. They paced the room. They were whispering. They were hissing. It was a nightmare for me.
Did they look in complete desperation?
Yes. Yes, at various stages of the conversation, they lost control of themselves. I just sat in my chair. I just listened. I did not even react. I didn't ask them questions. I was just listening. Well, and then
they wanted to convince you to convey.
They realized from the beginning that I don't know, that I don't understand this problem. Once I said I will take messages from them, they wanted to inform me what is happening to the Jews. And I didn't know this. I was never in a ghetto. I never dealt with the Jewish matters.
And did you know yourself at the time that most of the Jews of Warsaw had already been killed?
I did know. But I didn't see anything. I never heard any description of what is happening over there. I was never there. It is one thing to know statistics. There were hundreds of thousands of Poles also killed, of Russians, Serbs, Greeks. We knew about it. But it was a question of statistics.
But did they insist about the complete uniqueness of the
of yes, the this was their problem. To impress upon me, and then was my mission, to impress upon all people whom I am going to see, that the Jewish situation is unprecedented in history. Egyptian pharaohs did not do it. Babylonians did not do it. Now, for the first time in history, actually, they came to the conclusion, unless the Allies take some unprecedented steps, regardless of the outcome of the war, the Jews will be totally exterminated. And they cannot accept it.
This means that they ask for very specific measures. Yes. For the...
So then, interchangeably, at a certain point, the Bund leader, at a certain point, the Zionist leader. Then what do they want? What message am I supposed to take? Then they gave me messages, various messages. To the Allied governments as such, I was to see as many government officials as I could, of course. Then to the Polish government, then to the President of the Polish Republic, then to the international Jewish leaders, and to individual political leaders, leading intellectuals, approach as many people as possible. And then they gave me segments. To whom do I report what? So now, in this nightmarish, two meetings I had with them, nightmarish meetings, well, then they presented their demands, separate demands. The message was, Hitler cannot be allowed to continue extermination. Every day counts. The Allies cannot treat this war only from purely military strategic standpoint. They will win the war if they take such an attitude. But what good will it do to us? We will not survive this war. The Allied governments cannot take such a stand. We contributed to humanity. We gave scientists for thousands of years. We originated great religions. We are humans. Do you understand it? Do you understand it? It never happened before in history what is happening to our people now. Perhaps it will shake the conscience of the world. We understand. We have no country of our own. We have no government. We have no voice in the Allied councils. So we have to use services, little people like you are. Will you do it? Will you approach them? Will you fulfill your mission? Approach the Allied leaders. We want an official declaration of the Allied Nations that in addition to the military strategy which aims at securing victory, military victory in this war, extermination of the Jews forms a separate chapter. And the Allied Nations formally, publicly announce that they will deal with this problem, that it becomes a part of their overall strategy in this war. Not only defeat of Germany, but also saving the remaining Jewish population. Once they make such an official declaration, they have air force. They drop bombs on Germany. Why cannot they drop millions of leaflets informing the German population exactly what their government is doing to the Jews? Perhaps they don't know it. Now, let them make official declaration, again, official, public declaration, that if the German nation does not offer evidence of trying to change the policy of their government, German nation will have to be held responsible for the crimes their government is committing. And now, if there are not such an evidence, to announce publicly, officially, certain objects in Germany will be bombed, destroyed, as a retaliation for what the German government is doing against the Jews. That bombing which will take place is not a part of the military strategy. It deals only with the Jewish problem. Let the German people know before bombing takes place and after bombing takes place that this was done and will continue to be done because Jews are being exterminated in Poland. Perhaps it will help. They can do it. This they can do it. This was one mission. Next. Both of them. Particularly the Zionist leader. He was again like whispering, hissing. Something is going to happen. The Jews in the Warsaw Ghetto are talking about it. Particularly young elements. They will fight. They speak about declaration of war against the Third Reich. Unique war in the world history. Never such a war took place. They want to die fighting. We cannot deny them this kind of death. By the way, I didn't know at that time Jewish military organization emerged. They didn't tell me about it, only that something is going to happen. The Jews will fight. They need arms. We approached the commander of the Home Army, the underground movement in Poland. Those arms were denied, refused. They cannot be denied arms. If such arms exist, and we know you have arms. This message to commander-in-chief, General Sikorsky, to issue orders that those arms will be given to the Jews. This was another part of the mission. There are international Jewish leaders. Reach as many as possible. Tell them this. They are Jewish leaders. Their people are dying. There will be no Jews. So what for do we need leaders? We are going to die as well. We don't try to escape. We stay here. Let them go to important offices in London, wherever they are. Let them demand for action. if it is refused. Let them walk out. Stay in the street. Refuse food. Refuse drink. Let them die. In view of all humanity. Who knows? Perhaps it will shake the conscience of the world. Between those two Jewish leaders, somehow, this belongs to human relations, I took, so to say, to the Bund leader. Probably because of his behavior. He looked like a Polish nobleman, a gentleman, straight, beautiful gestures, dignified. I think that he liked me, also personally. Now, at a certain point, he suggested it. He says, Mr. Witold, I know the Western world. You are going to deal with the English. Now, you will give them your oral reports. I am sure it will strengthen your report if you will be able to say, I saw it myself. We can organize for you to visit the Jewish ghetto. Would you do it? If you do, to the Jewish ghetto in Warsaw, I will go with you. So I will be sure that you will be as safe as possible. A few days later, he will establish contact. By that time, Jewish ghetto, as it existed in 1942 until July, did not exist anymore. Out of approximately 400,000 Jews, in the meantime some 300,000 were already deported from the ghetto. So within the outside walls, practically there were some four units. The most important was the so-called central ghetto. They were separated by some areas inhabited by the Aryans already, some areas not inhabited by anybody. There was some building. This building was constructed in such a way that the wall which separated the ghetto from the outside world was a part of the back of the building. So the front was facing the Aryan area. There was some tunnel. We went through this tunnel without any kind of difficulties. who struck me completely different man. The Bund leader, the Polish nobleman. I go with him. He is broken down, curbing, like a Jew from the ghetto, as if he lived there all the time. Apparently, this was his nature. This was his world. So we walked the streets. He was on my left. We didn't talk very much. He led me. Well, so what? So now comes the description of it, yes? Naked bodies on the street. I ask him, why are they here?
Corpses, you mean?
Corpses. Says, well, they have a problem. If the Jew dies and the family wants some burial, they have to pay tax on it. So they just throw them in the street.
Because they cannot pay the tax.
Yeah. They cannot afford it. So then they say, every rag counts. So they take their clothing. And then once the body, the corpse, is on the street, yes, Judenrat has to take care of it. Women with their babies, publicly feeding their babies. But they have no breast, it's just flat. Babies with some crazy eyes looking.
Did it look like a complete strange world?
What?
Other world, I mean.
It was not a world. This was not humanity. Streets full. Full. Apparently all of them lived in the street. Exchange. What was the most important? Everybody offering something to sell. 3 onions. 5 onions. Some cookies. Selling. Begging each other, crying, I am hungry. Was horrible, children. Some children running by themselves, or with their mothers sitting. It wasn't humanity. It was some hell. Now, this part of the ghetto, German offices were there in the central ghetto. If Gestapo released somebody, and Gestapo officers, they had to pass through the ghetto to get out of it. So there were also Germans, German traffic. Now, the Germans in uniform, they were walking, silence. Everybody frozen until he passed. No movement, no begging, nothing. Germans, contempt. This is those apparently dirty subhuman. They are not human. They, Now, at a certain point, some movement starts. Jews are running from the street I was on. We jumped into some house. He just hits the door, open the door, open the door. They open the door. We moved in. Windows go, give to the back of the street. We go to the opposite, in the door. Some woman opened the door. Says, all right, don't be afraid. We are Jews. He pushes me to the window. Look at it, look at it. There were two boys. Nice looking boys. Hitler Jugend uniforms. They walked. Every step they made, Jews disappearing, running away. They were talking to each other. At a certain point, a boy gets to his pocket. Without even thinking, shoots. Some broken glass, some shouting, The other voice, something, congratulating him. They go back. So I was paralyzed. Then a Jewish woman, probably she recognized me, I don't know that I'm not a Jew. She embraced me, go, go, it doesn't do you any good, go, go. So we left the house. Then we left the ghetto. So then he said, you didn't see everything. You didn't see too much. Would you like to go again? I will go with you. I want you to see everything. I will. Next day we went again. The same house, the same way. So then again, now I was more conditioned. So I felt other things. Stench, stench, dirt, stench. Everywhere, suffocating. Dirty streets. Nervousness, tension. Some bedlam. This was Platz Muranowski. In a corner of it, some children playing something with some rags, throwing the rags to another. He says, they are playing, as you see. Life goes on, life goes on. So then I said, they are simulating playing. They don't play.
It was a special place for playing?
In the corner of Platz Muranowski. No, 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 open. So I say they
are... There were trees?
There were a few trees, Rashidic trees. So then we just walked the streets. We didn't talk to anybody. We walked probably 1 hour. Sometime he would tell me, looked at this Jew, a Jew standing, without moving. I said, is he dead? Says, no, 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 he's alive. Mr. Witold, remember, he's dying. He's dying. Look at him. Tell them over there. You saw it, don't forget. We walk again. It's macabre. Only from time to time, he would whisper, remember this, remember this? Or he would tell me, look at her. Very many cases. I would say, what are they doing here? His answer, they are dying. That's all right, they are dying. Then always, but remember, remember? We spend more, perhaps 1 hour. We left the cat. Frank and I couldn't take it more. Get me out of it. And then I never saw him again. I was sick. I don't want. I understand your role. I am here. I don't go back in my memory. I couldn't take any more. But I reported what I saw. Yes, it was not a world. Was not a part of humanity. I was not part of it. I did not belong there. I never saw such things. I never... Nobody wrote about this kind of reality. I never saw any theater. I never saw any movie. This was not the world. I was told that these are human beings. They didn't look like human beings. And we left. He embraced me then. Good luck, good luck. I never saw him again.
Sie haben keine Erinnerung von dieser Zeit?
Sehr wenig. Ich kann mich erinnern, Bergtouren vor dem Krieg besser als an die ganze Kriegszeit und auch als diese Zeit in Warschau. Nicht? Denn das ist, irgendwie war das doch eine bedrückende, eine schlechte Zeit. Eindeutig, dass der Mensch schlechte Zeiten, Gott sei Dank, leichter vergisst als schöne Erinnerungen. Die sind verdrängt, nicht?
Ich werde Sie helfen zu erinnern. Sie waren in Warschau der Assessor von Dr. Auerswald.
Ja.
Dr. Auerswald war
Kommissar für den jüdischen Wohnbezirk in Warschau.
Dr. Grassler, das ist Tscherniakow Tagebuch. Er schreibt über Sie.
Ach, die sind gedruckt, existieren die?
Ja, ja. Ja. Er hat ein Tagebuch geschrieben. Und das ist nur jetzt veröffentlicht. Er schreibt, und das ist 7. Juli 1941.
Am 7. Juli 1941, das erste Mal, dass ich ein Datum selber wieder erfahre. Ja. Darf ich mir da einen Zettel nehmen? Das, ich hätte natürlich genug da, nicht? Aber das interessiert mich auch. Nicht? Denn ich habe nie, also dann war ich im Juli schon dort.
Ja, und er schreibt, Juli 1741, morgen in der Gemeinde, das heißt jüdische Gemeinde,
ja, ja, ne.
Und später mit Auerswald Schlosser.
Schlosser war.
Und Grassler.
Ja.
Gewöhnliche Sache. Das ist das erste Mal, dass sie.
Dass der Name erwähnt wird, ja.
Ja,
ja.
Ja.
Aber da waren wir also anscheinend zu dritt. Schlosser war, glaube ich, Wirtschaftsverwaltung. Also ja. Der Name ist mir noch in Erinnerung, dass der mit der Wirtschaft zu tun hatte.
Ja. Und das zweite Mal, das ist Juli 22.
Hat er jeden Tag festgehalten?
Ja.
Ja?
Mhm. Ja, jeden Tag.
Jeden Tag.
Damit das ist ja sehr erstaunlich.
Dass das gerettet worden ist. Ne? Erstaunlich, dass das gerettet worden ist.
Adam Tscherniakow began keeping a diary the very first week of the war, before the Germans entered Warsaw, and before he took over the responsibility of leading the Jewish community, and kept his diary in daily entries until the afternoon of the day that he ended his life. He left us a window through which we can observe a Jewish community in the terminal hours of its life, a dying community, for it began dying from the beginning. And in that sense, Adam Tscherniakow did something very important. He didn't save the Jews. In that respect, he was like other Jewish leaders. But he left the record of what had happened to them in a day-by-day fashion. And you could see that he did all this on top of working a seven-day week, for here was a man without vacations, without any day off. And yet every day, almost every day, he had an entry. He might record the weather, where he went in the morning, and then all the things that happened. But he never failed to write. That was something that moved him, pushed him, compelled him throughout the years, almost 3 years of his life under the Germans. And in that sense, perhaps because he wrote in such a prosaic style. We now know what went on in his mind, how things were perceived, recognized, reacted to. And we even know from what he didn't say just what it is that went through this community. There are constant references in the diary to the end. He talks in terms of Greek mythology, and he refers to himself as wearing a poisoned cloak, as Hercules once did. He has a feeling of doom for the Jews of Warsaw. And there are remarkable passages in the diary that illustrate what he meant. He is sarcastic enough, if that is the word, in December 1941 to remark that now the intelligentsia were dying also. Up to this point, poor people were dying, but by December 1941, members of the intelligentsia were starving to death. And he even has...
Why does he mention specifically the intelligentsia at this time?
He mentions it because there is a difference owing to the class structure within the ghetto in vulnerability to starvation. The lower classes died first. The middle class died a little bit later. Intelligentsia were, of course, at the top of the middle class. And once they started dying, the situation was really very, very bad. And that's the meaning of that. Now, we're dealing with a ghetto where the average consumption was about 1,200 calories, you see. He mentions it with approval, that one petitioner came to him for money and said, I want money not in order to eat. I want money for the rent, to pay the rent for my apartment, because I don't want to die in the street. This is the kind of comment that Chernyakov writes down in his diary. This meaning of dignity. The approval.
You mean he received a petition from somebody?
Yes.
Who said, give me money.
Yes, but not for food. Give me money so that I can pay the rent. Because I don't want to die in the street. There were people dropping dead in the street. Who were covered with newspapers.
Why was the housing more important to him than the food?
To this particular individual who wasn't eating enough to remain alive, who didn't want to be dying of hunger while collapsing in the street.
This means that death was not avoidable, but it was avoidable to die either inside or outside.
Of course. It is one of these sardonic jokes of which he had quite a few. He always had the strange description of a band playing in front of a funeral parlor, of a hearse with drunken drivers, and a dead child running around the grounds. He had rather sardonic comments about death. He lived with death.
Haben Sie das Ghetto besucht?
Selten, aber ich war ein paar Mal drinnen. Nicht? Ich war also bei Chernyakov.
Und wie war es? Wie waren die Zustände?
War entsetzlich. Das, ja. Schrecklich, ja.
Ja.
Nein, also, ich bin nicht ins Ghetto gegangen, nachdem ich es mal kennengelernt hatte. Und wenn ich nicht musste, also ich war in der ganzen Zeit wohl nur ein paar Mal dort. Nicht? Also, ja, das war also, ich meine, das Bestreben der Dienststelle war ja an sich, das Ghetto zu erhalten, auch für die Arbeitskräfte. nicht? Und vor allem auch eben die Seuchen zu verhindern, dass Fleckfieber ausbricht. Das war ja die große Gefahr, nicht?
Ja.
Ja.
Aber können Sie über Fleckfieber reden?
Ja, ich bin kein Mediziner. Ich weiß bloß, dass also Fleckfieber eine sehr gefährliche Seuche ist, die also dann praktisch ähnlich wie die Pest die Menschen wegrafft und die man natürlich nicht in einem Ghetto halten kann. Also wenn das Fleckfieber im Ghetto ausgebrochen wäre, ich glaube nicht, dass es war, aber die Gefahr war und die Angst, dann hätte es wahrscheinlich auch die Polen erfasst und dann sicher auch die Deutschen. Nicht? Also,
ja, aber warum gab es Fleckfieber in dem Ghetto?
Ja, ich weiß gar nicht, ob es gab. Es war die Gefahr des Fleckfiebers und doch wahrscheinlich immer durch die Hunger. Nicht? Ich meine, die Leute haben doch zu wenig zu essen bekommen. Das war ja das Schreckliche. Nicht? Und es konnte ihnen eben, es war wohl nicht mehr da. Nicht? Also, sagen wir mal, die Dienststelle Kommissar hat versucht, die Ernährung des Ghettos möglichst gut zu halten, damit eben das Ghetto nicht eben zu einer Seuchenquelle wird. Nicht? Also jetzt vom Menschlichen abgesehen, allein schon aus diesem Seuchengrunde. Denn wenn Fleckfieber in größerem Maß ausgebrochen wäre, ich glaube nicht, dass es jemals war, nicht? Dann hätte es eben nicht an der Ghetto-Grenze Halt gemacht.
Tscherniakow auch schreibt, dass ein Grund für das Ghetto-Einrichtung war diese deutsche Angst.
Ja, sicher.
Für Fleckfieber. Dass die Deutschen haben immer identifizieren die Juden mit Fleckfieber.
So war es wohl, ja. Wobei ich nicht weiß, ob das nun begründet war. Ne? Aber sagen wir mal, durch diese Menschenmassen, die ja nun im Ghetto zusammengedrängt wurden. Es wurden ja immer, kamen ja nun nicht bloß die Warschauer Juden, sondern später auch die anderen. Ne? Jetzt war die Gefahr natürlich immer größer. Ne?
There is a lady somewhere in Warsaw. In love with a man. And the man was hit, grievously wounded, with his insides coming out. This woman stuffed the insides back with her own hands. She carried the man to a first aid station. He died. He was buried in a mass grave. She disinterred him and buried him. This to Tscherniakow, this simple episode, was the ultimate of virtue.
He's never revolted.
He doesn't bother, or he doesn't express the revolt, he doesn't express the disgust except with other Jews. Jews who either deserted the community by emigrating early, or Jews who, like Ganzweich, are collaborating with the Germans. And for the Germans, he doesn't have words of disgust. I think he is beyond such words. He hasn't any criticism of the Germans themselves, and only seldom allows himself to make a remark which indicates that he opposed something by arguing. He very seldom argues with the Germans. He pleads, he appeals, but he doesn't argue with them. He does argue when he's forced not only to build the wall, but to pay for it. And he says that if the wall is being put up as a hygienic measure to prevent Jewish epidemics from engulfing the Polish or German population outside, then why is it? Why is it that the Jews have to pay for it? The people who get the protection should be paying for the medicine. If the wall is medicine, let the Germans pay. And Auerswald, the ghetto commissar, says that's a very nice argument that he, Chernyakov, might bring up at an international conference someday, but for now he'll pay for the wall. Chernyakov writes all this down, including Auerswald's reply to his own argument. And that's about the most he ever allows himself to say in criticism of what the Germans are doing. So he takes for granted, he assumes, he anticipates everything that is happening to the Jews, including the worst.
Es gab eine deutsche Politik für das Ghetto in Warschau. Und was war diese Politik?
Ja, da fragen Sie mich zu viel. Die Politik, die dann schließlich zur Vernichtung geführt hat,
ja.
Die sogenannte Endlösung, die war uns ja natürlich nicht bekannt. Unsere Aufgabe war ja, das Ghetto zu erhalten und die Juden eben möglichst auch als Arbeitskräfte zu erhalten. Sagen wir mal, das Ziel der Dienststelle, des Kommissars, war im Ergebnis ein ganz anderes als das Ziel, das später eben zur Vernichtung geführt hat.
Ja, aber wissen Sie, wie viele Leute sind gestorben jeden Monat im Warschau-Ghetto in 1941?
Das weiß ich nicht. Ne? Das, jedenfalls weiß ich heute nicht, ob ich es damals gewusst habe.
Aber Sie haben gewusst, weil es gibt ganz genaue Statistik.
Wahrscheinlich habe ich es gewusst. Dass, ne?
Ja. Das, aber 5000 pro Monat.
5000 pro Monat?
Ja.
Also,
und das ist sehr viel.
Das ist sehr viel, freilich.
Ja.
Andererseits war es ja auch eine sehr viele Menschen im Ghetto. Ne? Viel zu viele eben, das war es ja.
Viel zu viele.
Viel zu viele, das ist es ja.
Meine Frage ist eine philosophische Frage. Was heißt ein Ghetto in Ihrer Meinung?
Ja Gott, Ghettos gibt es in der Geschichte, soweit ich weiß, seit Jahrhunderten. Nicht? Die Frage der Judenverfolgung ist ja keine deutsche Erfindung und keine Erfindung des Zweiten Weltkriegs. Nicht? Die Polen haben ja auch die Juden verfolgt.
Aber ein Ghetto wie in Warschau, in eine ganz große Stadt, in den Herz.
War wohl ungewöhnlich.
Sie sagen, dass man wollte das Ghetto erhalten.
Sag mal, es ja. War Aufgabe des Kommissars, das Ghetto nicht zu vernichten, sondern das Ghetto am Leben zu erhalten. Es war ja nun
auch. Aber was heißt Leben mit einer solchen?
Das war ja das Problem.
Ja.
Das war ja das Problem, nicht? Es sollte ja auch doch gearbeitet werden. Das wurde ja
aber
gearbeitet.
Die Leute sind gestorben auf den Straßen. Eben. Es gab Leichen überall.
Eben.
Ja. Ja.
Das war das Paradoxe an der ganzen Geschichte.
Ja? Ja, glauben Sie, es war ein Paradox?
Ja, entschieden.
Ja. Aber warum? Können Sie das erklären?
Nein.
Warum nicht?
Ja, was soll ich da erklären? Die Tatsache war, dass einerseits...
Ja, aber es war nicht Erhaltung. Diese Juden waren vernichtet jeden Tag in dem Ghetto.
Wirklich erhalten hätte man es nur können mit wesentlich höheren Lebensmittelrationen, ne? Und nicht in dieser Zusammendrängung. Ne?
Aber warum gab es keine menschliche Rationen? Warum gab es keine? Es war eine deutsche Entscheidung, nicht?
Ja, bloß sagen wir mal, die Entscheidung war wohl nicht, das Ghetto auszuhungern, sondern diese große Entscheidung, die Juden zu vernichten, die kam doch erst viel später.
Ja, bloß das kam später, das kam in 1942.
Ja, eben. Nicht? Während damals,
ein Jahr später.
Ja, während damals eben, soweit ich noch weiß, eben unsere Aufgabe war, für das Getter zu sorgen, wobei natürlich nicht möglich war, zu verhindern, dass bei diesen ungenügenden Rationen und bei diesen Massen eben doch eben große viel zu viele Todesfälle gab. Ne?
Ja. Ne? Ja, aber was heißt, ein Ghetto zu erhalten in solche Ernährungszustände, ja, Hygienikzustände und so weiter? Was könnten die Juden machen gegen solche Maßnahmen?
Die Juden konnten nichts machen. Ne?
Tscherniakow saw a film before the war, where the captain of a sinking ship gives order to the orchestra to play jazz. In the entry of July 8, 1942, not even 2 weeks before his death, he identifies himself to this captain of the sinking ship. And of course there is no jazz, but there is kind of children's festival.
There are chess tournaments, yes, there's theater, there's a children's festival, there's everything going on until the last moment. But more importantly, these are symbols. These outward cultural activities, these festivals, they're not simply morale-building devices, which is what Tscherniakow identifies them to be. Rather, they are symbolic of the entire posture of the ghetto, which is in the process of healing or trying to heal sick people who are soon going to be gassed, which is trying to educate youngsters who will never be growing up, which is in the process of trying to find work for people and increase employment in a situation which is doomed to failure. They are going on as though life will continue. They have an official faith in the survivability of the ghetto, even after all indications are to the contrary. The strategy continues to be, we must continue, for this is the only strategy that is left. We must minimize the injury, minimize the damage, minimize the losses, but we must continue. And continuity is the only theme in all of this.
But obviously, when he compares himself to this captain of a sinking ship, he knows that everything
He knows. I think he knew, or he sensed, or he believed the end was coming, perhaps as early as October 1941, when he has a note about alarming rumors as to the fate of Warsaw Jewry in the spring. This is also when Bischoff, the head of the Transferstelle, tells him that, after all, a ghetto is only a temporary device, without specifying for what. He knows because in January he has premonitions or reports and rumors about Lithuanians coming. He is concerned when Auerswald disappears and is going to Berlin, right around January 20, 1942, which we now know to have been the date of the Final Solution Conference in Berlin, the Wannsee Conference. And even though Tscherniakow in Warsaw behind the walls has no idea of such a conference going on in Berlin, yet he is concerned that Auerswald, the ghetto commissar, is going to Berlin. He can't imagine why? Unless it is for a purpose that bodes no good. And so, in February, there are more rumors. In March, the rumors are becoming even more specific. He now begins to record the departure of Jews from the Lublin ghetto, or Mielec, or Krakow, and Lvov. And he recognizes That something may well be in the offing for Warsaw itself. And every subsequent entry is replete with the anxiety that he feels.
When Chernyakov hears the rumors about the deportations from Lublin, Lvov, and Krakow around March 1942, and we know now that the transports went to Belzec, does he ask in his diary where they are shipped? What happens to them?
No. He never does. But he never mentions any destination. But we cannot really decide that he had no knowledge whatsoever about these camps. All we know is that he didn't mention them in the diary. And we also know, of course, from other sources that the existence of death camps was already known in Warsaw, certainly by June.
Warum hat Chernyakov Selbstmord gemacht?
Weil er wohl erkannt hat, dass eben keine Lebensfähigkeit mehr für das Ghetto bestanden hat. Und wahrscheinlich hat er eben früher als ich erkannt, dass die Juden umgebracht werden sollten. Ja. Ich nehme an, dass, also sagen wir mal, sich schon, die Juden haben ja eigentlich einen Geheimdienst ganz gut gehabt. Nicht? Die wussten mehr, als sie wissen sollten. Und die wussten mehr, als wir wussten.
Glauben Sie das?
Das glaube ich, ja. Ja.
Die
ja.
Juden wussten mehr als
ja.
Sie.
Ja.
Als Sie
ja. Da bin ich überzeugt. Da bin ich überzeugt.
Das ist schwer zu
doch.
Zu akzeptieren.
Denn die deutschen Dienststellen, die wurden ja nie informiert über das, was nun, sagen wir mal, mit den Juden geschehen sollte. Ne?
Wann waren die ersten Deportationen für Treblinka?
Ich denke vor Auschwitz Selbstmord.
Vor Auschwitz Selbstmord?
Nein, vor Chernyakov Selbstmord. Entschuldigung.
Nein. 22. Juli.
Das sind Daten, die ich eben nirgends mehr. Also 22.07.42 Beginn der Deportationen.
Ja.
Nach der Blinker.
Und Chernyakov hat Selbstmord gemacht. Am 23.
Naja, das ist dann
ein Tag später.
Ein Tag später. Also da hat er dann eben wohl erkannt, dass seine Idee, denn ich glaube, es war seine Idee, mit den Deutschen ehrlich zusammenzuarbeiten und dabei für die Juden das Beste herauszuholen, dass das eben einfach zerstört war, diese Idee und dieser Traum.
Er hat verstanden, dass diese Idee war ein Traum.
Ja. Und wie der Traum zerstört war, glaube ich, hat er eben die Konsequenz gezogen.
The last entry takes place how long before his suicide?
The last entry precedes his death by a few hours.
And what does he write?
It is 3 o'clock. So far, 4,000 are ready to go. The orders are that there must be 9,000 by 4 o'clock. This is the last entry of a man on the afternoon of the day that he commits suicide.
The first transport of the Jews of Warsaw for Treblinka was the 22nd of July 1942, and he committed suicide the day after.
That's right. In other words, on the 22nd, you see, on the 22nd, he's called in by Sturmbannführer Höfle, who is in charge of the resettlement staff, who has come in there for the express purpose of taking the Jews out of Warsaw. Höfle tells him, on the 22nd. And here, incidentally, is another fascinating point. Chernyakov is so agitated that he doesn't put the date down correctly. Instead of saying July 22nd, 1942, he says July 22nd, 1940. Höfle calls him in at 10 o'clock. Disconnects the telephones. Children removed from the playground opposite the community building. And then he is told that all Jews, irrespective of sex and age, with certain exceptions, will be deported to the East. To the East. Again, the East. And by 4 p.m. today, a contingent of 6,000 people must be provided. And this, at the minimum, will be the daily quota. Now, he's told that at 10 in the morning of July 22nd, 1942. He then goes on. He keeps appealing. He wants certain exemptions. He wants the council staff to be exempt. He wants the staff of the welfare organizations to be exempt. And he's terribly worried that the orphans will be deported, and he repeatedly brings up the orphans. And on the next day, he still doesn't have assurance that the orphans are going to be saved. If he cannot be the caretaker of the orphanage, then he has lost his war. He's lost his struggle.
But why the orphans?
They're the most helpless element in the community. They are the little children, its future, who have lost their parents. They cannot possibly do anything on their own. If the orphans do not have exemption, if he doesn't even get the promise, the word spoken by a German SS officer, not even assurances, which, as he knows, cannot be counted on, if he cannot even get the words, what can he think? If he cannot take care of the children, what else can he do? Some people who report that he wrote a note after he closed the book on the diary in which he said, "They want me to kill the children with my own hands."
Sie glaubten damals, dass diese Ghetto-Idee war eine Gute Idee, es war Selbstverwaltung, nicht?
Ja, die Selbstverwaltung
eine kleine hat an sich. Stadt.
Die hat an sich gut funktioniert.
Ja, aber die jüdische Selbstverwaltung für tot, nicht?
Ja, im Ergebnis, und heute wissen wir es. Damals wussten.
Oh, damals auch.
Nein.
Tschernjakow schreibt das. Das ist, er sagt, wir sind eine Marionette, wir haben keine Macht.
Ja.
Wir haben keine Kraft.
Ja, sicher. Sicher war das.
Sie waren die Herren. Sie, die Deutschen.
Ja, natürlich.
Sie waren die Herren, sie waren die Meister.
Ja, natürlich. Ja.
Und Tschernjakow war ein Werkzeug.
Ein Werkzeug,
in ihre Hände.
Ja, aber ein gutes Werkzeug. Also die jüdische Selbstverwaltung hat gut funktioniert, das weiß ich. Ja.
Hat gut funktioniert während 3 Jahren. 42, 2,5 Jahre und am Ende.
Am Ende kam.
Gut funktioniert für was? Für welches Ziel?
Schon für die Selbsterhaltung, nicht? Also,
nein, für Tod.
Ja.
Selbstverwaltung, Selbsterhaltung.
Das,
für Tod.
Das können wir heute leicht sagen. Nicht?
Ja, aber Sie haben mir gesagt, dass die Zustände waren. Unmenschlich,
ja,
furchtbar, schrecklich. Das heißt, es war schon klar in diesem Zeit.
Nein, sagen wir mal, die Vernichtung war nicht klar. Ergebnis.
Die Vernichtung, das ist nicht so einfach, weil es gab einen kleinen Schritt und einen anderen Schritt und einen anderen Schritt.
Ja.
Und das ist Vernichtung. Ja. Ja. Aber um diese kleinen Schritte zu verstehen, muss man.
Darum ist ja die Vernichtung zumindest zum Beginn nicht im Ghetto selbst erfolgt, sondern durch den Abtransport. Ne? Sonst hätte man ja damals das Ghetto.
Welcher Transport?
Den Abtransport nach Treblinka. Man hätte ja das Ghetto, weiß Gott, mit Waffen oder was vernichten können. Ne?
Ja.
Wie es dann später geschehen ist, nach dem Aufstand. Nicht? Lang nach meiner Zeit, nicht? Aber zunächst mal, ne? Ja, lass mal, wir drehen uns im Kreise. Ne? Wir kommen zu keinen neuen Ergebnissen.
Nein, ich glaube, es ist unmöglich, zu neuen Ergebnissen zu kommen.
Und was ich heute weiß, das habe ich ja damals nicht gewusst. Ne? Und das ist,
Sie waren nicht ein kleiner Mann.
Sie waren schon ein kleiner Mann.
Wichtiger Mann.
Da überschätzen Sie diese Rolle. Ne?
Nein. Sie waren der Vertreter von der Kommissar für jüdische Wohnbeziehungen in Warschau.
Aber ohne Macht.
Das ist etwas. Mhm. Sie waren ein Teil von dieser großen deutschen Macht.
Richtig, aber ein kleiner Teil. Sie überschätzen, was ein damals 28-jähriger Assessor machen konnte.
30 Jahre.
28.
30 Jahre, das ist. Das ist der. Das ist die Maturität, das ist die Reife.
Ja, aber für einen Juristen, der mit 27 Jahren ungefähr das Examen macht, ist das der Anfang. Ne?
Ja. Sie waren Doktor.
Ja, das besorgt doch nichts, das ist ein Titel.
Aber was war der Doktor auch?
Nein, aber der Titel besagt gar nichts. Nicht?
Dr. Yu.
Ja.
Und nach dem Krieg, was haben Sie gemacht?
Ich war in einem alpinen Verlag, habe Bergbücher und Bergzeitschriften gemacht.
Ah ja?
Ja. Also Führer geschrieben und Führer herausgegeben für die Berge. Ja. Eine alpine Zeitschrift gemacht.
Das ist Ihre Hauptinteresse, Bergen?
Ja.
Bergen und Luft und Sonne und frische Luft.
Keine Ghetto-Luft.
schreibt zu dir, seiner nicht mit Tint, nur mit Tränen. Joren, die Beste, geendigt sich, seiner nicht mit Tint, nur mit Tränen. Joren, die Beste, geendigt sich, und schon verfallen, nicht zu werden. Schwer ist zu verrichten, was ist zerstört, und schwer ist zu verbinden, unsere Liebe. Ascho, die Tränen deine, die Schuld ist nicht meine, weil er so muss sein, so muss sein, so muss sein. Wir müssen beide sich zerscheiden. Also muss sein, also muss sein. Die Liebe endigt sich von beiden. Zu gedenkst du, wenn ich hab dich gelassen den Weg. Mein Geurl hat gesagt, ich muss von dir weg, weil in den Weg will ich schon keinmal mehr nicht sterben. Weil also muss sein.
J'ai commencé à boire après la guerre. C'était très difficile.
Claude Rotzer, la date, et Maïta Regachati, l'Ohaya. מלקקת ליבי היה נירל.
Claude, vous avez demandé quelle était mon impression. Si vous pouviez lécher mon cœur, vous seriez empoisonné.
שפת אנוש דלה מדי בכדי לתאר את הגיהנום בתוך הגטו מעל פני הקרקע, מתחת לפני הקרקע, רק בכדי להדגים במשהו, אז מספיק אם אני אומר שאי אפשר היה לעבור ברחובות הגטו שלמעשה לא היו קיימים, אלא היה צריך לעבור מעל גופות של בני אדם שנערמו זו על זו במאות, אולי באלפים. אבל בנוסף למלחמה בגרמנים, היה עלינו ללחם ברעף, במחלות ובצמא, מכיוון שהכל נותק, היינו מנותקים מכל העולם. לא ידענו מה שנעשה סביבנו, בקושי ידענו מה שנעשה אצלנו בתוך הבונקר.
Je crois que la langue humaine est incapable de décrire l'horreur que nous avons connue dans le ghetto. Dans les rues du ghetto, si nous pouvons encore employer le mot de rue, parce qu'il n'y restait plus de rue, nous étions obligés d'enjamber des cadavres qui s'entassaient les uns sur les autres. Nous n'avions plus de place où passer, et en dehors de la lutte contre les Allemands, nous luttions contre la faim, contre la soif. Nous n'avions aucun contact avec le monde extérieur. Nous étions complètement isolés et coupés du monde.
היינו חסרי אונים להתמודד עם כל הבעיות בפניהם הועמדנו. ובסוף גם לא ראינו שום טעם בהמשך המלחמה בתוך חורבות הגטו.
Nous étions dans un tel état que nous avions fini par cesser de voir la signification même de la poursuite de la lutte.
וכך נוצר הרעיון לנסות ולהפקיע דרך לצד הארי מחוץ לגטו.
Nous avons pensé tenter une percée vers le côté arien de Varsovie en dehors du ghetto.
Or le jour 1er mai, נשלחו שני אנשים, זיגמונד ואנוכי, על מנת ליצור קשר עם אנטק שיצא לצד הארי.
Juste avant le 1er mai, on nous a envoyé Zygmunt et moi pour essayer d'entrer en contact du côté arien de Varsovie avec Antek.
ואומנם נמצאה מנהרה שברחוב בוניפרטרסקה שהובילה מתחת לרחוב, מתחת לפני אדמה, מצד אחד של הרחוב לצד השני.
Nous avons fini par trouver un tunnel sous la rue Bonifratesca qui permettait d'aboutir dans le côté arien de Varsovie.
כשמצאנו את עצמנו ברחוב, היה מוקדם בבוקר, 1 למאי, שמש זרחה.
Le matin, très tôt, nous nous sommes retrouvés soudain dans la rue, en plein jour.
לא האמנו שאנחנו נמצאים בעולם הזה, באנו בכלל מפלנטה אחרת.
Imaginez ce 1er mai ensoleillé. Stupéfait de nous trouver là au milieu de gens normaux dans la rue. Et nous qui sortions d'une autre planète.
הקיפו אותנו מיד אנשים שרפצו בסביבות הגטו ותמיד היו מתנפלים על כל יהודי שהיה יוצא. היינו חשודים בעיניהם וזה לא היה קשה, היינו קרועים ובלויים, תשושים, רזים.
Immédiatement, des gens nous ont sauté dessus parce que nous avions certainement l'air très épuisés, maigres, en haillons. Il y avait toujours autour du ghetto des Polonais très suspicieux qui attrapaient des Juifs.
Itzlachnu erchu litchamek midehem.
Par miracle, nous avons réussi à leur échapper.
החיים בצד הארי של הגטו התנהלו כרגיל.
Du côté arien de Varsovie, la vie continuait de la façon la plus naturelle et la plus normale comme le passé.
בתי קולנוע עבדו ובתי קפה היו פתוחים והמסעדות פעלו. הטראם היה נוסע והאוטובוסים נסעו.
Les cafés fonctionnaient normalement, les restaurants, les autobus, les trams, les cinémas étaient ouverts. Le ghetto était une île isolée au milieu de la vie normale.
הבעיה שלנו הייתה ליצור קשר עם יצחק צוקרמן ולארגן פעולת הצלה בכדי להוציא את כל אלה שעדיין נותרו בחיים מבין לוחמי הארגון היהודי הלוחם.
Notre tâche était d'entrer en contact avec יצחק צוקרמן pour essayer d'entreprendre une opération de sauvetage, essayer de sauver les quelques combattants qui pouvaient encore se trouver en vie dans le ghetto. Nous avons réussi à entrer en contact avec Yitzhak Zuckerman. Nous avons trouvé deux employés de la compagnie des égouts.
ובלילה, בין השמיני לתשיעי למאי, אחרי שעת העוצר, ירדנו לתעלות הביוב, אני, רישק, שני עובדי תעלות הביוב, והתחלנו בדרך לתוך הגטו.
Dans la nuit du 8 ou 9, nous avons donc décidé de retourner au ghetto avec un autre camarade, Rishek, les deux égoutiers. Et après le couvre-feu, nous avons pénétré dans les égouts.
Taynut netunim lechazdam shel shnei ovdei ta'alot abiyuf ki ach verak hem hikiru et ha'ta'alot.
Nous étions entièrement livrés au bon vouloir de ces deux égoutiers puisque eux seuls connaissaient la topographie souterraine du ghetto.
באמצע הדרך, עובדי תעלות הביוב התחרטו ולא רצו להמשיך. רק כאשר איימנו עליהם בנשק, הם הועילו להמשיך.
Ils ont, au milieu de notre marche souterraine, décidé de rebrousser chemin. Ils ne voulaient plus nous accompagner et il a fallu les menacer de nos armes.
הגענו לתעלת ביוב מסוימת.
Nous avons progressé à l'intérieur de l'égout.
ואז עובדי תעלת הביוב אמרו לנו שאנחנו נמצאים כבר בגטו.
Et à un certain moment, l'un des égoutiers nous a dit que nous nous trouvions sous le ghetto.
סוכם שרישק ישמור עליהם שהם לא יברחו.
Rijek a été chargé de garder les deux égoutiers pour qu'ils ne puissent pas s'évader.
אני פתחתי את המכסה ויצאתי החוצה.
C'est moi qui ai soulevé le couvercle des égouts pour pénétrer dans le ghetto.
במילה 18, איחרתי ביום אחד.
המילה 18, Je les ai manqués en fait d'une journée.
אני באתי בשמיני לתשיעי למאי בלילה. בשמיני למאי בבוקר גילו את הבונקר.
Mon retour s'est déroulé dans la nuit du 8 au 9. Le bunker a été découvert par les Allemands le matin du 8.
רובם איבדו את עצמם לדעת וחלק הורעל בגזים על ידי הגרמנים.
La plupart des survivants du bunker se sont soit suicidés, soit ont été empoisonnés par les gaz.
כשהגעתי לפרנצ'ישקנסקה 22 וצעקתי את הסיסמה המוסכמת, איש לא ענה לי. פתאום שמעתי מהחורבות קול של אישה.
Je me suis rendu au bunker de Frantsishkanska 22. Il n'y avait personne lorsque j'ai crié le mot de passe. J'ai donc été obligée de continuer dans le ghetto et soudain j'ai entendu une voix de femme qui appelait du milieu des ruines.
כן, שמעתי קול מתוך הריסות, הרי אור לא היה, הכל היה חשוך, זה היו הריסות של בתים. והלכתי לפי הכל, זה היה כמו פאטה מורגנה. אני חושב שאני לפחות חיפשתי כחצי שעה, לפחות לפי דעתי, אם כאילו הסתכלתי על השעון, אבל לפי הערכת הזמן שלי, הסתובבתי מסביב. כל הזמן הלכתי לפי הכל ולא הצלחתי לאתר אותה.
Il faisait nuit, nuit noire, on ne voyait rien, rien n'était éclairé, il n'y avait que des ruines, des maisons écroulées, et je n'entendais qu'une voix, il me semblait que c'était vraiment une espèce de mauvais sort qui était jeté, une voix de femme qui parlait du fond des décombres, et j'ai fait le tour de ces ruines, je n'avais bien sûr pas regardé ma montre, mais j'ai l'impression que j'ai bien passé une demi-heure à faire le tour, à essayer de retrouver d'après ce son de voix qui me guidait, et malheureusement je ne l'ai pas trouvé.
Il y avait des incendies.
היו בעירות אז?
לא, כבר לא בער מבחינת להבות אש. עוד פה ושם היה עשן. היה ריח של בשר חרוך של אנשים שנסחפו כנראה חיים.
On ne peut pas vraiment parler d'incendie puisqu'il n'y avait plus de flammes qui montaient. Cependant, il y avait encore de la fumée et puis cette horrible odeur de chair roussie de gens qui certainement avaient été brûlés vifs.
טוב, המשכתי משם ליתר המקומות שאני ידעתי ששם צריכות להיות הקבוצות הלוחמות. וחזר על עצמו אותו הסיפור, אני הצגתי את הסיסמה ואיש לא ענה לי. ואחרי שהתחוצצתי בתוך הגטו מספר שעות, התחלתי ללכת בכיוון לתעלת הביוב.
J'ai donc continué ma route. Je me suis rendue aux autres bunkers où je pensais trouver les unités combattantes. Et chaque fois, la même histoire se reproduisait. Je lançais le mot de passe. Yann?
Quel?
D'un prénom polonais, Yann.
Chem
polonais.
Oui. Aucune réponse. Je quittais le bunker pour aller dans un autre bunker. Et après des heures de course à travers le ghetto, je suis retournée en direction des égouts.
Il était seul à ce moment-là.
Azaïta Levad.
Quel a été colossalement Levad?
Oui, j'étais tout le temps seul.
Colossalement, là, il אישה הזאת שלא מצאתי אותה, והגבר שפגשתי בו מתי שמיד אחרי שיצאתי מתעלת הביוב, ושני הקנליזטורים ורישה כשהם היו בתוך התעלה, והייתה נפש חיה בכל הגטו. ואז בדרכי בחזרה לגטו ברגע מסוים, הרגשתי שלווה גמורה מבחינת שלוות נפש. חשבתי שאני האיש האחרון, היהודי האחרון, ולא היה לי חשק בכלל לחזור כבר לתעלת הביוב. החלטתי שאני נשאר ואני מחכה עד הבוקר לגרמנים, ואז יהיה הסוף.
À part la voix de femme dont je vous ai parlé et un homme que j'ai rencontré au moment où je suis sortie des égouts, j'étais seule tout au long de mon parcours du ghetto. Je n'ai rencontré nulle âme qui vive. Et je me souviens d'un moment où j'ai ressenti une espèce de tranquillité, de sérénité, où je me suis dit, je suis le dernier juif, je vais attendre le matin et je vais attendre les Allemands.